teams. Dean Favoni, your team pulled off an upset against Oak Park. What can you tell me about that? Can you take the momentum from that?
Well, we're going to have to. Our big concern right now is our point guard went out with an injury late in the game and won't play today. And I guess the key for us today is just to control the tempo.
Now, you guys are the underdogs. Is that a bit of a problem for you?
It worked last night, so no, that's okay today.
Yeah. All right. I know you're anxious to get back. We'll let you go. Thanks so much.
Thank you very much.
Daniel Mack, Kerry Lasuk, you guys were ranked two out throughout the season. You guys are here now. What does your team have to do to win the championship?
We got to continue what we're doing, and that is play a very up-tempo game. The court is much bigger than us, so we don't want to get into a half-court set too often with them. So we're going to try to keep a high-speed game and make it real exciting and run that ball up and down the court as fast as we can.
Now, are you a little concerned because they have a lot of momentum with that upset?
Yeah, Dean, Coach Favoni's done a great job with these boys, and they're peaking at the right time. And we've talked about that a lot in our pre-games and things like that. So we're aware of that, and we're going to try to take it away from them right at the beginning if we can.
All right, thank you so much. Good luck in the game.
Thank you.
Once again, we're here at the 4A Basketball Provincial High School Championships. We're going to face off between Oak Park and, the Daniel Mack Maroons and the Dakota Collegiate, the Dakota Collegiate Lancers.
Internet is a road with lots of interesting places to visit, and kids need guidance when it comes to sightseeing on it. There are places they shouldn't go, information they shouldn't give out, and things they shouldn't buy. Internet providers in the cable industry have partnered with the Government of Canada and Media Awareness Network to raise awareness. These websites have timely and reliable information on safe internet practices for children. There are lots of great places for kids to explore. Just point them in the right direction.
Celebrity models, Manitoba Moose players, and great prizes to be won, all in support of the Rehabilitation Center for Children.
We'll be using the funds to help Manitoba's children with disabilities live with much greater independence and ability in their lives.
Join Tracy Koga and Jim Ingebrigtsen for a great night of fun and fashion at Winnipeg's hottest club, Metso, 291 Bannatyne.
It's going to be March 21st, 7 o'clock. Come and see.
For tickets, call 475-5073.
There's a lot happening at Shaw TV these days. We'll be bringing you two brand new shows a week, plus introduce a new member to the team.
Hi, I'm Bob Baker, your newest member of your Shaw TV team. I'll be covering the local sports scene as well as politics, so watch for me on Shaw TV.
So tune in every Monday and Thursday for brand new stories, new series, and hot contest giveaways. Catch us on Shaw TV.
Back to the 4A High School Provincial Championships at the Duckworth Center. I'm Bob Baker. We are about to get underway with the boys game between the Daniel Mack Maroons and the Dakota Lancers. But first, Morris Klimcher of the Manitoba High School Athletic Association. You had a busy day today. Can you recap some of the action?
Well, we have eight different championships going on this weekend. There's championships in Burrill, Russell, Cordial Prairie, Steinbach, and in Winnipeg. And one of the games I just got back from Point Duchesne School from St. Anne beat Pegwis in that championship. Just a super game. So there's some great basketball going right across Manitoba right now.
So you guys have another tournament coming up soon?
Well, the next thing is badminton at the beginning of May. Then we go into June where we have fastball, track and field, and soccer. So it's starting to wind down, but still a lot of action, a lot of activity for high school sports.
Thank you very much, Morris. We're going to go up, back up to Sean and Missy with, well, play-by-play, or actually we'll get underway with the announcing of the players here at the Duckworth Center.
Thank you very much, Bob. Once again, I'm Sean Coates, and this is Missy Penner, and we're here at the University of Winnipeg's Duckworth Center. The girls' action concluded about 20 minutes ago, and now we're ready for the boys. It's the Daniel McIntyre Maroons taking on the Dakota Lancers. Missy, some of your thoughts as we look ahead to this boys' game.
Well, this should prove to be a very good game, just like the girls was. We've got number two, Daniel Mack, up against number four, Dakota. Dakota has really turned things on in the latter part of the season here, winning their zone, coming in fourth rank, and pulling off that big upset against Oak Park. Oak Park and Daniel Mack had been ranked one and two off and on throughout the entire season, so that was a huge win for Dakota. We'll see if they can keep that momentum into this game. Daniel Mack on the other side, they've been one and two all season, strong team. Couple really great players to watch. Irfan Nashaspour is just a player that really puts on a good show like he did the other night, and I'm sure he's going to do that tonight in this championship game.
That's right, Missy. It's not going to be a game. It's going to be a show. We're going to see some great basketball action here in our boys' game. And right now, we're going to go back down to our public address announcer, Bill Anthony, who's ready for the introduction of today's starting lineups.
Number 24, Grant Short. Number 32, Dylan Fries. Number 33, Igor Jurek. And number 44, Chris Morissette. We'll meet the starting lineup shortly. The home team on the scoreboard, the Daniel McIntyre Maroons, advanced to the final by defeating Glenlawn in the regionals, and last night rolled over the Silver Heights Huskies 91-74. Let's meet the Daniel McIntyre Maroons. Number six, Mark Molinar. Number seven, Mike Tan. Number eight, Marco Lopez. Number 10, Ken Messer. Number 14, Jason Paleo. Number 15, Rupert Capina. Number 23, Roy Rodriguez. Number 30, Aaron Goodmanson. Number 11, Milan Villanian. Number 20, Josh Teo. Number 4, Justin Mariano. And now let's meet the starting lineups. From Dakota, 5'7 guard, number 13, Marshall Jones. From Daniel Mack, 5'10 guard, number 3, Marvin Capaccio. From Dakota, 6'3 guard, number 21, Trevor Shaw. From Daniel Mack, a 5'8 guard, number 13, Irfan Nashaspour. From Dakota, a 6'3 guard, number 23, Dan Hamlin. For Daniel Mack, a 6'1 forward, number 9, Sherwin Medina. For Dakota, 6'10 post, number 42, A.J. Durbin. From Daniel Mack, a 6-foot post, number 5, Paul Avalanosa. From Dakota, 6'3 guard, number 55, Alexi Findley. From from Daniel Mack, a 6-3 post, number 12, Ian Bursley McClellan. The coaches from Dakota, Dean Finley, Corey Rothenberger, Dean Sacco, Brian Kidd, for the Daniel Mack Maroons, Greg Bouchard, Jason Papone, and Terry Lasuk.
There you have the introduction of tonight's lineups. The boys are on the court, and we're getting ready to rock some rims. Missy, number two versus number four. Let's see how they got here.
Well, Dakota, number four, got a bye first round, then went on to play Sisler, number five ranked, beat them 70-41, and then pulled off the upset against the number one ranked Opark, 63-56. Daniel Mack on the other side also had a bye first round and then beat Glenlawn number 10, 87-74 in overtime. And then last night beat Silver Heights number three ranked 91-74.
Action now underway. Dakota draws first blood. Scoring underneath Alexi Finley to open things up. This is going to be a very fast-paced game as we see Villanova on the other end for Daniel Mack. We're tied at two. Let's set the stage. Dakota wearing their traditional black with gold numbers. They go up against the Daniel McIntyre Maroons, who of course are wearing white with maroon trim.
That's right, and I'll tell you, at home you don't want to blink or even get up at any point because you'll probably miss a ton of steals by Nassar Spoor. He did it the other night. He put on quite a show, so stay tuned because you're going to want to pay attention.
And there he comes up with his first one, intercepting that pass, goes back down the other way to Passio with the shot. It's good!
Tocasio, one of the top shooters on the Daniel Mack squad. He is just an outstanding player, ranked number seven in the province.
5-2 our score. We're just a minute underway. From the other side, it's Dakota. The shot goes up, doesn't fall for Marshall Jones. You better strap on the helmets, folks. This is going to be an extremely hot game. Nassar Spoor, NBA 3, 8-2 Mack.
Well, he does everything for the team. Believe it or not, one of the smaller players, 5'8", he leads the team in rebounds as well.
Oh, the big man the other way, Alexi Finley. He's got four. Quick, fast break pass. Count the basket of Villanova. 10-4, Daniel Mack, a minute and a half in. You never know, this thing could hit 100 the way this game's going right now, Missy.
Well, if Daniel Mack puts the pressure on Dakota, they're going to have a hard time bringing that ball up the court because their defense is absolutely outstanding. And another thing that Nassar Spoor does extremely well is pass the ball. So he's got a number of assists as well for the team.
Finley, again, opportunity. He's fouled. Looks like Villanova will get his first personal. Missy, one of the things we haven't even had a chance to talk about, the action being so fast and furious, is the starting guard, David Harvey White, the man who brings the ball to the court for Dakota, got injured in the semifinal. He's not playing tonight.
That's right. He was one of the top guards for Dakota, really controlled the ball, and he got injured the other night, last night. So unfortunately for him and for Dakota, he will not be on the floor. So he is actually being replaced by number 23, Dan Hamlin, who is also a grade 12 guard.
Finley misses the first. He hits the second. Leads cut in half, 10-5. Not even 2 minutes into this one. Nassar Spoor, other end. In and out, doesn't go. Finley battles for the ball. He comes up with it. Alexi getting his first board of the night. Gives it up to Dan Hamlin into the front court for the Lancers. Lob pass down low. That's the other big man, A.J. Gervais, 6'10 post.
Well, Shaw almost went up for that shot, almost traveled, but passed the ball off just in time to Hamlin.
Hamlin hits the deuce. We're 10-7.
Well, the interesting thing in this final is Dakota has absolutely nothing to lose here. Ranked number four, they've already come up with an upset. So they're going to go strong here. And here again, we see Nassar Spoor with another 3 point.
Another 3 point basket. Nassar Spoor lighting it up, 13-7. Daniel Mack. Shaw, right side, gives it up. 3 point attempt doesn't go. Finley gets another board. Up strong, hits it. And he's fouled.
We'll see who this foul goes against. If it goes against number five, that's his second foul. That's Paul Villanova.
Villanova, as you mentioned, we're only 2:43 in or so. He's got his second foul, and we're going to have a substitution. Daniel Mack making a sub. It's going to be number 23, Roy Rodriguez, coming into the game. That's bad news. for Daniel Mack that Avila-Noza has two fouls this soon in the ball game. Finley at the line, he completes the three-point play. And he's got 7 of the 10 so far for Dakota. Shot from the outside is short, air ball taken by Hamlin.
We won't see that too often by Topacio. He's known for his shooting abilities. Actually got a fantastic shot, looks very smooth, and there's another steal. You're gonna see Daniel Mack pick the pockets of the Dakota players all night.
Makes the pass, takes the shot, nails it. You mentioned Topacio is not gonna air ball after missing that first one. He drains that deuce, 15-10, Daniel Mack.
Yeah, he's one of the top shooters on the Daniel Mack squad, so you're gonna see him perform tonight.
Hamlin to Shaw, down low Finley. Alexi seeing the rock a lot early on, pumps it, hits it, and that's why.
That's a good mismatch for Dakota because they've got number 23, Roy Rodriguez, who's only 5'11", and Finley stands at 6'3".
Nash's poor ball fake, takes the three, it's money!
Well, he created some space there, you saw him step forward. Dakota defense backed off and that left them wide open and he can drain it.
Nash's poor has 9, Finley has 9 for Dakota, 18-12, Daniel Mack with the lead. Shaw inside, Gervais goes up tough and hits it. AJ draws his first deuce of the night. We're at 18-14.
Well, and that's their big player for Dakota, AJ Gervais, 6'10". So look for him to get a lot of the balls inside.
Ball's rebound underneath by Shaw. And already, he's our Shaw player of the game.
There's no question, and for Dakota, he is one of their top shooters. He had a fantastic game last night against Oak Park.
Hamlin up top, being guarded, I believe it's by Topacio, yes. Shaw lobs down low, looking for Finley, really well. Second steal tonight for Nash's poor. He starts back the other way. 2-on-4, he'll do it anyways, up off the glass. Finley with the board, that's his third. Pushes it ahead to Shaw. He's in the front court, quick pass ahead. Shaw, or sorry, Jones this time, Marshall Jones. Ball's passed back. Nash's poor had a chance at the steal, but it went out of bounds. He might have let that one go out of bounds and taken possession himself,
is it? That's right, but with his quickness, I'm sure he expected to get that ball, and most of us probably would have expected that because, I'll tell you, he's one of the smoothest players. He's the number one player in the province, as rated in the Winnipeg Sun, and he is just so smooth. You'll see him on the floor, and all of a sudden, like the speed of lightning, he'll just take off.
Shaw can't control it. It goes out of bounds. Coming into the ballgame, number 15, Rupert Capena for Daniel McIntyre to replace Jerwin Medina as Funky Gold takes a seat. Into the front court, Nash's poor with the ball again for Daniel McIntyre. Finds Topacio. Topacio works the ball inside. Daniel Mack trying to go inside there. But the ball's turned over, back the other way. It's Shaw, thought about the three, gives it to Hamlin instead, back to Shaw. Logged down low, Gervais up in double traffic. He hits it, and he's fouled.
Again, Dakota's gonna have to do a lot of that. They've gotta get the ball inside to their two big players, Gervais and Finley, 6'10 and 6'3.
Saw some of the Dakota fans in the crowd all dressed up here as Gervais at the line, he hits it, leads cut to one. This is a great ball game, 4:34 to go here in the first quarter. It's 18-17, Daniel Mack, they have the ball. Topacio, right side. Ball's worked around Nash's poor on Shaw. He drives, up in traffic, oh my! Oh my, oh my!
Well, you talk about that show, this is just a carryover from last night, I'm telling you. You've gotta watch this guy, he is just something else.
Oh. That is just some legitimate talent.
Harry right almost there. Came up with the steal there.
Gervais at the other end, working it in, kicks it out. Up with the shot, no good for Marshall Jones. Coming back the other way, Nash's court lead pass. Finds Topacio for three. Traveling violation call before the shot. Topacio must have just moved his foot before he went up.
It looked like he did, and he got called on the travel.
Shaw to Hamlin, 3:40 to go in the first, 2017, Daniel Mack. Hamlin back to Shaw, working on Topacio, trying to get it into Finley. Ball slapped out of bounds by Topacio. Lancers will maintain possession. There's Greg Bouchard yelling out instructions to his Daniel McIntyre team. Finley with it on the wing, gives it to Hamlin. Shaw, three-point territory from the corner, doesn't go. Nash is poor with a big board. He starts down the floor, fast-paced first quarter so far. Oh, nice interception by Hamlin.
That was a very good heads-up play by Hamlin, something you don't see too often by Nash's poor. Again, getting a piece of that one. He really goes for the steal. You'll see him just pickpocket a lot of the players.
He's already got two or three, we believe, at least two that we know of. Hamlin with it now, working against number 15, Capena. Ball goes inside. Finley, who's got nine of his own, pumps, takes it. Oh, it's so easy for Alexi inside.
He had a strong game last night, and he's starting off strong again tonight.
11 of his team's 19 points. They trail by one. Shot goes in and out, doesn't fall for Nash's poor. Ball goes to Hamlin. Hamlin into the front court, working against Capena. Ball's kicked out. Drive on the play, foul from behind. This might go against DiPasio on the reach. It is. That's his first. That's team foul number four of the half.
Daniel Mack is known for their very aggressive defense, so you're going to see them. Sometimes they're going to get called on that, but it will not stop them because a lot of times they are successful with those steals.
Gervais had the ball, kicked it up top. Jones now with it. After receiving it from Finley. Good ball movement here by the Lancers. In the ball game, Thorderson. Finley on the tip. It falls for him. He's having a great quarter, 13 points.
And they take their first lead of the game, 21-24, Dakota.
They've certainly come on in the second half of the season, and they're playing with full measure here against Daniel McIntyre, the number two rated team in the province. Nice fake by DiPasio. Shot doesn't drop for him, however.
And this foul will go against number 15, Rupert Capena.
That'll be team foul number five, the first against Capena. Substitution of it. Villanoza coming back into the game. He's only played a couple minutes after picking up two fouls early on. We've got 1:52 to go here in the first quarter. Dakota by one at 21-20. Hamlin with the ball. Thorderson. Back to Hamlin. Thorderson right side. Up top Hamlin. Lob down low. Finley double team. Ball stopped from behind. And back the other way comes Nash's poor. Oh, nice look away, pass in the middle, finishing it off is IBM, Ian Birchley McClellan.
Again, Nash's poor, just doing everything for Daniel Mack. He always, always sees the open man.
Thorderson tries to pass across. Ball's taken by Jones up in traffic. Doesn't go, it's tipped around, and Nash's poor comes up with the board. One on two the other way, it doesn't matter. He goes up and draws the foul. You know, most people think one on two is a disadvantage, not Nash's poor. He thinks it's an advantage for him.
That's right. He is not afraid of driving in. He really does everything for Daniel Mack. He is, again, the number one player in the province. He was the MVP at the Luther tournament. On the team, he averages 22 points a game, 12 rebounds, 10 assists, and 8 steals.
It's amazing. And he was also approached by Jay Triano, my old friend and former classmate out in BC, coach of our national team.
That's right. And last night in his semifinal game, he had 34 points.
It's amazing. And he's certainly on his way to another solid night already. He's got nine. Finley has 13 on the other side for Dakota. Ball stolen by Nash's poor, but it hit his foot. So the ball will remain in the possession of the Dakota Lancers. Lancers team bound in the front court. It's Hamlin. Gives it to Jones. He's in the backcourt now, advances it in to the front half. Jones works half spin. Picks up his dribble, finds Thorderson. Hamlin lobs it down low, Gervais. Gervais, nice move around, and he throws down the two-handed jam.
Well, you can't let him just dance around you. That's exactly what he's going to do. At 6'10", he has the ability to dunk that ball.
Just did the hook spin around the defender and threw down the dunk. Nash's poor back the other way. Shot does not go. Gervais with the board. Jones racing down the left side of the court. He's got Finley with him. Pulls it out, gives it up top to Hamlin. 7 seconds left in the quarter. Traveling violation call. Daniel Mack's got to put it up. Nashis Poor at the buzzer. Long shot doesn't go, but what an excellent quarter of basketball. Daniel McIntyre, the number two rated team in the province, 23. The Dakota Lancers, the number four ranked team in the province, also with 23. We're tied after one.
Work the other side. Okay, if Irfan's guarding Dan, avoid that side. If he's on Marshall, avoid that side. Work the other side. Okay? Keep in turning. Hey, if Irfan, keep having Trevor bring the ball up. Okay? Stay behind him. Keep turning around and in turning, look at the hoop. Okay? We're doing a good job, guys, at this end. Okay? Just keep a hand up. They're not penetrating, they're okay. Okay? We're doing fine. Relax. Relax. Okay? Expect maybe a bit more pressure. Trevor's throwing it in. And whoever Irfan is guarding, get out of the way. Just take him down the floor and clear him out.
Let's go, guys.
3, 2, 1.
What's
that?
A little warm in here.
Get a look at some of this raucous crowd here. We're sitting in amongst a bunch of Daniel McIntyre fans here, and they've been very loud, but it's been equally as boisterous on the other side here, Missy, as we're getting ready for our second quarter of action here.
Well, this gym is absolutely packed to the rims here, and we are I think sitting on the entire side of Daniel Mack. I think the entire student body, staff included, is here.
Better than the normal attendance on a school day, from what I understand. So
that's right. Maybe it's a credit course.
It's a credit course, exactly. We have to give them credit for playing some great basketball here so far. Tied at 23. Dakota with the ball. It's Hamlin. Finds Shaw. Down low, Gervais. Kick back out to Hamlin. Ball's worked across to Jones. He's trying to find Finley. As is Hamlin, who gets it to him. Finley goes up. He's been just magic tonight. He's got 15.
Well, that was a good turn into the basket. I actually thought he traveled a little bit there, but he wasn't called on it. So great play by Dakota. They just got the steal and bringing up the ball, and almost another steal by Tapasio.
Shaw wisely fakes it and then gets it across safely to Hamlin. Ball's into Gervais. He's double teamed as Daniel Mack collapses on the Dakota big man. There's Finley. He's double teamed as Medina, Funky Cole Medina, back in the game. He slaps it out of play.
Good that he took time from making those CDs.
Yes, and hit records. Shaw gets it into Hamlin. Right back to Shaw. They go inside Gervais. He's got position. And he's got another two-handed jam.
Well, Ian Bursley McClellan stood his ground there, was standing straight up, and A.J. Gervais just went right around him.
IBM with the ball there now, gives it inside. Shot goes up, it's good. Daniel McIntyre getting back on the board, 27-25. Lancers with the lead and the ball. Hamlin. Daniel Mack in a man-to-man defense here, but they are doubling when they get the chance. Shaw inside, Gervais fakes it, kicks it outside Jones. They'll go right back to Gervais. Gervais to Jones again. He's wide open. Might as well let him shoot it, and he hits the three. 5-point lead, biggest of the game for either side. Dakota with the advantage.
Well, a lot of people thought this would be an easy game for Daniel Mack, but Dakota already did it against Oak Park. You can't take them lightly.
3-point attempt from the outside, no good. Gervais with a huge board going over top of IBM. Shaw to Hamlin. Shaw to Finley. He goes up tough. 17. I think he's hit everything underneath this. Timeout on the floor called by Daniel McIntyre. The lead is 7 by Dakota. 32-25. 7:42 to go in the second. There's the tail on your television screens right now. And when we get a chance, we'll go in to one of the timeouts.
You are
are 5 steps off every guy that's supposed to be guarded in a full court situation. We have to pick up and put pressure on the ball. We need to create turnovers. That's what we need to do. Not sit back and allow their big people. They're bigger and stronger, and if you allow that to happen, it's over. We're playing their speed, not our speed.
So what push. Pick it up with your defense. We want to have that defensive quickness that has got us here. That means more pressure at full court, half court, three-quarter court. Let's get some pressure on them. Cause the turnovers. Cause the turnovers. Make sure you're on the right side of it. Okay?
3-2-1.
Obviously, from the comments of Coach Bouchard and Coach Lassuk, they're worried about the tempo of this game. Missy, in any sport, you want to control the tempo and you want to dictate the style of play. Daniel McIntyre is not doing that. It's been Dakota that's dictated it thus far. The coaches recognize that.
That's right. And he also talked about they're bigger and they're very strong. And Daniel Mack is known for their quickness. If they were to put some pressure on them, Dakota might have some difficulty even bringing the ball up, because Daniel Mack just is known for stealing, and just they are one of the quicker teams.
Finley on the offensive end, his first miss of the night. But he still has 17 of his team's 32 points. We've got 7:16 to go, and they're actually going to call Finley on the foul there. No, they give it to Gervais instead. That'll be his first, team foul number two. And that's one of the things, when Dakota controls the game the way they have, they're not in as much foul trouble. Nash is poor from just outside the free throw line. When he works off the screen like that and he's open, he's going to hit it 9 times out of 10.
Oh, for sure.
Jones the other way for Dakota. There's the steal that Coach Bouchard and the Super are looking for. The other end, it's Tapasio. He makes no mistake. Leads cut to 3 at 32-29.
Tapasio had 23 points the other night in their semifinal game.
Finley double-teamed at the half court. He gets rid of it. It's intercepted. Tapasio again, easy layup. He's not going to miss that either. One-point ball game at 32-31.
Well, isn't this a coach's dream? They're totally listening to what the coaches said, and now they're performing, and they're setting the tempo of this game, and it's definitely working in Daniel Mack's favor.
How long will Dean Pavone go on the other end before he makes an adjustment? Shot up by Shaw. Doesn't go. There's a foul from behind. Missy, they haven't adjusted the scoreboard here. It was 32-29, and not only have we recognized it, but so have the Daniel Mack coaches. They've now changed it. It's 32-31, as we thought, so everything is right at the bench, as we got a shot there of Dean Pavone, and we had it right in the truck. Of course, Lisa Schreier operating the CG tonight, doing a great job there. There
right.
You see some of the things that we're, some of the noise we're sitting in the middle of here, Missy, with everybody with these Canada noisemakers, fire sticks. And I tell
I know,
you,
I just hope we don't get hit with them.
And that shaking you see isn't a faulty camera. That's everybody pounding the stands here and creating an atmosphere here that is very much unique to high school sports. 33-31 the score, 6:08 to go here in the first half. Nash Espoir works off the screen, fakes it, goes inside. Ian Bursley McClellan up top. Doesn't hit it, but he gets fouled, and IBM will go to the line to shoot two.
That's a good play for Daniel Mack to get the ball inside to their big guy, Ian Bursley McClellan, because what it could also do is draw a foul on some of the Dakota players and put them in foul trouble. So they need to do that as well.
Dylan Fries, the 6'6" forward for Dakota, will check in after this 20-second timeout as we get a look at Phil Sam. There's the packed house we're talking about, Missy, and there you see some of the people batting those Canada fire sticks. When I was at Grey Cup in Montreal, there were 65,000 people with those things. They're very loud.
I know they are.
When you guys have to put the ball on the floor, or anybody does, don't pick it up over the timeline. Keep going. Don't stop in the corner. Okay? Relax.
One of the points that Dean Pavone made was what we saw happen with Alexi Finley on that last trip up court. They advanced the ball into the front court and then stopped, picking up their dribble and getting trapped or double teamed at the midcourt line. So he just told them to continue on. A good point there by Coach Pavone. His team up by 2 at 33-31. However, Ian Bershley McClellan at the line for Daniel McIntyre, trying to shave his lead.
That's right. You don't want to get trapped in the corner there right at the center line. I believe a lot of coaches refer to that as the idiot zone.
Yeah. I lived out there.
You usually had a chair right in that corner, didn't you?
Yeah, they gave me a postal code. After that shot, the second shot by Virgil McClelland was missed. Villanoza came up with a rebound and was fouled. He'll go to the line. His team down by one, just under 6 minutes to go here in the second quarter. Get a look there, Jerwin Medina. Instead of going to the line, they'll give the ball on the baseline. Entered in, worked around Medina. Topacio pulls up from about 12. It's good. Daniel Mack regaining a lead at 34-33.
Topacio, one of the smarter players on Daniel Mack, a straight-A student, hopes to become a doctor.
Hamlin with the ball, finds Shaw. Back to Hamlin, wasn't expecting the pass. Shaw kicks it out. Jones for three. He's hot tonight, too.
Oh, that's a great shot by Jones, taking advantage of that three-pointer.
Virgil McClelland underneath. He traveled. His foot slid while he was underneath the hoop. 36-34 Dakota, 5:22 to go. Lexi Finley with the ball. The big man, as we mentioned already, with 17 points. He pushes Shaw off and says, I'll inbound the ball. Gives it to Jones. To Hamlin. Shaw to Finley. Finley up top. He's got 19 now.
Well, both Finley and Gervais were co-MVPs at the St. Vital tournament.
One of the better tournaments in the city for high school basketball. Nash is poor with a shot. In and out doesn't go. He gets the rebound eventually. He drives, penetrates up top amongst the trees. He draws a foul, and this may go against Finley. If it does, it'll be his second.
So that'll put Irfan Nashashpour on the line, back at the line.
And it is Finley's second. Team foul number 5.5. 5 minutes and 1 second remaining here. 4-point lead, cut to three by Nashashpour.
Nashashpour is being scouted by the Winnipeg Westmen, Brandon Bobcats, and Regina Cougars, some of the top university teams. I'm wondering, where's U of M?
Yeah, where is U of M in that? Yeah, where's UVic, UBC, Moncton, where are all those other schools? Because they're missing out on a great talent here, that's for sure.
There's no question. Could you imagine if the Westmen land Nashashpour and they've already got Alvin Smalling, one of the top players from last year? That will really make them a strong force.
Dave Cook coaching the team now in his first year, has worked with our national team, an excellent coach, that's for sure. And we see Shaw hit a three-pointer. He's back up to five now. Four goal answers at 41-36.
Well, Shaw, one of the great perimeter shooters for Dakota, had many Shaw turning points last night against Oak Park.
Yes, he did. And he's playing well here on Shaw tonight. Ball's rebounded underneath by Finley. He protects the rock despite getting a lot of hacking and whacking on his arms, and there's a breakaway pass just a little too far for Dylan Freeze.
Looked like he was looking at the basket a little too soon and didn't quite bring that ball down.
Nashashpour, Topacio, Villanoza, ball's back up top. Nashashpour puts up the shot off the front of the rim, rebounded by Jones. Kicks it across to Hamlin. Hamlin scans the defense and enters the front court. Works his way down the right side. Jones to Shaw. They get it down low to Finley. Backs his way in against IBM. Misses a short little three-footer. And back comes Daniel Mack. Long lead pass down the floor. Villanoza puts up the shot. It's good. Three-point ball game.
Well, another great assist by Nashashpour and a great shot. Way to hesitate by number five, Paul Villanoza.
Hamlin working against Nashashpour. Great guard matchup there. Hamlin gets the ball back. Works it right side. They'd love to get the ball down low to Finley again. They do. Finley up top. A huge game for Finley. He's got 21 points, and we've only got 3 minutes to go in the first half. Nashashpour, he's dealt up a dozen already here this evening himself. Gets it to Villanoza. Topacio from three-point territory, just a little off. Ball's rebounded by Freeze. 2:45 to go, 43-38 Dakota.
Kota holding on to that lead. Nice move by Hanlon to get around. That's just poor. And Finley going up for that shot.
Finley felt he was fouled from behind. That's why he couldn't get the shot up. But it still remains in Dakota's possession. Checking back into the game, Roy Rodriguez for Daniel Mack. He'll replace Ian Bursley McClellan. Dean Favoni, coach of Dakota, likes what he sees so far. His team up by five. Finley, double team, gets the ball knocked out of his hands. And quickly down the court, Daniel Mack. It's Medina up top. He hits it. Jerwin Medina remaining composed on the breakaway.
Well, and it was Medina the other night, or I guess a couple, I guess it was about a week ago, actually, against Glenlawn, who hit the three-pointer to force the overtime.
Back the other way, Nashus poor breakaway opportunity. He didn't miss that. The lead's cut to one, 43-42. Full court pressure again by Daniel Mack. Make it three-quarter pressure. They come up with a steal. Topacio gives Daniel Mack the lead. They're up by one.
Well, and this is sort of the big trait of Daniel Mack, is putting on this full court pressure and creating a ton of turnovers.
Almost getting the ball there was Paulo Villanoza. That's what Greg Bouchard was talking about in the earlier timeout, playing Daniel McIntyre basketball.
Great. And Greg Bouchard was the coach of the Canada Games team. He's in his, I believe, his second year at Daniel Mack. He's come over from Tech Bock. Kerry Lazouk has coached a number of years over, and part of the reason that Daniel has created this great program, he's coached a number of years at Daniel Mack.
Hamlin with the ball. Should note that Finley's gone for a rest with 1:38 to go here in the half. Both big men are out of the game right now for Dakota. Hamlin takes the three, forced it, but he hit it.
He hit that one on the way down, and still it found a way in, so they take the lead again. 46-44, 1:23 left in this second quarter.
Hamlin on defense telling Medina to bring it on, and he does with the shot. It doesn't go. Ball's rebounded by Shaw, gives it up to Jones. Jones will just try and slow things down with 1:10 to go here in the first half. Shaw back to Jones. Over to Shaw. Ball worked down low. Kicks back out. Freeze didn't see the return pass. Tries to push it out to Shaw. Goes out of bounds. Dakota will hang on to it. 52 seconds to go.
Daniel Mack getting a piece of most of those passes here. You've got Shaw inbounding the ball along the sideline.
Igor Jurek's also in the ball game. I forgot to mention that earlier here for Dakota. Shaw on the outside with the ball. Hamlin, three-point territory. Shaw tries to go up with a shot. It's knocked out of bounds by Topacio. Good defense by Marvin. 37 seconds remaining. It's a two-point ball game in favor of Dakota. Shaw to Hamlin. Back to Shaw. They'd like to get it to Freeze, but he's being fronted really well by Rodriguez.
Tried a lot of contact underneath the basket. Got another steal by Nashus Poor. We'll see what he does this time.
Easy layup. He ties things up with 23 seconds to go. Shaw to Hamlin. Again, good pressure by Daniel McIntyre. Freeze to Shaw. 10 seconds to go now in the half. The ball's given to Freeze. Easy layup for Dylan Freeze. Two-point lead. Now with 3 seconds to go, back comes Nashus Poor. Can he hit one at the buzzer? Shot by Rodriguez is short. But we've been absolutely treated to a fantastic half of basketball action. The Dakota Lancers lead at 48-46 over the Daniel McIntyre Maroons here at halftime. As we just try and catch our breath here for about 10 seconds, let's talk about this first half of action. I mean, there are so many things we could talk about. Let's just talk first about the style of play. It's been fast, furious, and fantastic.
Well, it really has been a fast-paced game, and we saw Dakota actually dictating the play initially, but I'll tell you, Daniel turned things around, and when they did that and played their style, they brought themselves right back into this game. That's something they're going to need to continue if they hope to come out victorious tonight.
And also Dakota, towards the end of the half, their last 2 or 3 minutes, had both their big men out of the game, but it didn't seem to affect them as much. They were still able to score and get the ball in down low effectively. So really, both teams trying to assert their style of play, dictate their tempo, And with the exception of a few exchanges, no team has really gained too much of an advantage.
No, it's been point for point and exchanging leads a couple of times, but I mean, 48-46, who would have really expected this? I mean, it's been an outstanding final.
Oh, it certainly has, and I believe we are ready to rejoin our friend Bob Baker down at courtside. And Bob, what do you have for us?
That's right, Sean. It's an electrifying atmosphere here as Daniel Mack is trailing Dakota by a score of 46-48. Dakota got here by upsetting Oak Park. Now, despite their absence in the finals this year, the Oak Park Raiders basketball program has a certain consistency to it that rivals many other schools. Since 1976, Randy Cassano has been shaping and tweaking his program to the success it is today. However, it wasn't always championships and accolades for the program.
Well, when I first started out, we used to get killed a lot. Small school, about 300 plus students, but I watched a lot of the successful programs, in particular Dale Bradshaw at Dakota, Bill Wedlake at St. John's, and Dave Guss at Westwood, and they were extremely successful programs, and I watched them a lot and tried to copy what they did. I think every young coach takes what they receive from their coaches, and I've done the same thing. I was really fortunate to have some unbelievable coaches in my career. I had Ron Koski and Dennis Elvesett in junior high. They were fantastic. Dennis Wilson at the high school level, John Hunter, Jim Bullock. These are the best names in basketball in Manitoba, so I've been blessed with that.
Spearheading a successful sports program at any level for so many years takes a lot out of a person, and Cassano admits that it was starting to happen to him.
You know, about 10, 12 years into the program, I got a little bit tired, but one of the great things happened to me. I was on my own, and a young coach over in St. James, I guess, sort of got pushed out a little bit over at John Taylor, and I was able to talk him into coming over to Oak Park to help me out. His name was Darren Klapik, and that rejuvenated my whole coaching career, and it's been probably one of the best moves I've ever made was getting Darren to come over here and co-coach with me. We work really well together. We think a lot alike and have the same goals in mind and treat kids pretty much the same way. So, yeah, it's been a really good mix.
Despite all the accolades and championships his program has garnered, Cassano maintains a humble approach to his success.
I think that's just age. You know, I've been here for a long time, and I think it's strange for a person to be in a school for as long as I have, but I've been very lucky. It was a young school, sort of a young community, lots of young kids, young families, and it's grown, and I've been fortunate enough to grow with that. So it's been, I've been very fortunate that way. But I owe a lot to this community, the administrators I've had here, Rick Suffield at U of M for allowing me to coach at the next level with him at the University of Manitoba. Darren's been fantastic as far as a co-coach over the years. My family, unbelievable support, allowing me to pursue this game like I have. And probably, you know, and most of all, obviously, the players I've had throughout the years. I've had just wonderful kids, and I want to take this opportunity to thank all of them.
And with me, the other man of that program, Darren Klapik. You guys had an upsetting defeat, I guess, yesterday against Dakota. Tell me, how come that happened?
The kids came out, and they were flat. And you know, to be honest with you, we've been flat for about the last couple of weeks. Ever since we came back from Regina, we've just been lacking the jump that we had earlier in the year. Explanation for it, we're at a loss for it. To take nothing away from Dakota, because they played great yesterday, like they're playing this half right now. Of the four teams that came here this weekend, they were the team that's probably been playing, peaking at the right time. And full marks to them, they deserved their win yesterday.
Now you guys are going to try and rebuild. Hopefully you'll be back next year.
Yeah, we've got good returning grade 11s. We've got a freshman team that was very successful this year. And with Randy at the helm, they're going to be solid again.
Well, thanks so much. You had a great season. Congratulations on your season.
Thank you.
All right, we'll be back with more action from the 4A High School Provincial Boys Basketball Finals at the Duckworth Center right here on Shaw.
internet is a road with lots of interesting places to visit, and kids need guidance when it comes to sightseeing on it. There are places they shouldn't go, information they shouldn't give out, and things they shouldn't buy. Internet providers in the cable industry have partnered with the Government of Canada and Media Awareness Network to raise awareness. These websites have timely and reliable information on safe internet practices for children. There are lots of great places for kids to explore. Just point them in the right direction.
Celebrity models, Manitoba Moose players, and great prizes to be won, all in support of the Rehabilitation Center for Children.
We'll be using the funds to help Manitoba's children with disabilities live with much greater independence and ability in their lives.
Join Tracy Koga and Jim Ingebrigtsen for a great night of fun and fashion at Winnipeg's hottest club, Metsu, 291 Bannatyne.
It's going to be March 21st, 7 o'clock. Come and see.
For tickets, call 475-5073.
There's a lot happening at Shaw TV these days. We'll be bringing you two brand new shows a week, plus introduce a new member to the team.
Hi, I'm Bob Baker, your newest member of your Shaw TV team. I'll be covering the local sports scene as well as politics, so watch for me on Shaw TV.
So tune in every Monday and Thursday for brand new stories, new series, and hot contest giveaways. Catch us on Shaw TV.
Welcome back to the Manitoba High School Athletics Association 4A Basketball Championship. The finals on the boys' side. Dakota is leading Daniel Mack by a score of 48-46. Action is about to get underway once again. So let's head back up to Sean and Missy.
Thank you very much, Bob. Yes, we are ready for a great second half of action. We've got about a minute to go before we get there, but Missy, again, let's recap that first half. There was just so much action back and forth. These two teams asserted it right from the opening minute.
Well, it really has been action-packed here. It has you on the edge of your seat. I mean, right now, you cannot tell who's going to win this one because it's just been so close. Dakota is really, really playing well, and we talked about how they've really peaked towards the end of the season here. Daniel Mack, again, has been ranked one or two all season, but this one's still open for either one of these teams. I mean, right now, Daniel Mack is turn things around a little bit, maybe dictating their play.
Well, you know, Missy, you've been on the edge of your seat throughout the half, and you've actually been on the edge of my seat. You knocked me into the aisle once, and I'm still waiting for an apology on that one. But
actually, what I was trying to do is just get rid of you and take over the show here.
Which wouldn't be unusual for you, but hey, we need two people or three to commentate this game. There's just so much action involved. One person can't do it alone as we get a look at Greg Bouchard with some final... Last few final words before we start the second half. Dakota already on the court. And you see some of the Lancer fans on one side of the stands here at the University of Winnipeg's Duckworth Center. And Missy, let's talk about the records of these two teams while we have the chance.
Well, Daniel Mack is undefeated in league play, 14-0, and overall 35-2. Their two losses only coming to the hands of Oak Park, who got eliminated by Dakota. Dakota's league record 6-4 and overall 21-8, but really turning things around in the second half of the season.
And the second half of this game is now underway. Dakota with the ball. It's Jones to Shaw, down low. Finley, he's got a lane. He goes up top, misses it. Ball's rebounded by Bershine McClellan, gives up to Nashispor. Long pass down the floor to Passio, fakes it. Dishes to IBM. It's behind him and it's taken by Shaw. A little pitch and catch between him and Hamlin. And Shaw starts back down the floor. Picks up his dribble, goes to Gervais. Oh, nice move on the baseline. And he hits it.
Well, the big guys are really doing an outstanding job. That's Gervais and Finley for Dakota. We'll see what Daniel Mack can do here. They trail by 4, 50-46.
Villanoza looking down low to Passio, pulls up and hits it. Nice balance in the air by Marvin Tapasio.
That's right, and there were three Dakota players down there, and what he did was he just basically did a fadeaway shot, which created that opening for him.
Ball's thrown out of bounds. by Shaw. It'll go over to Daniel Mack. They trail by two at 50-48. We've played exactly a minute here in the third quarter. Topacio fakes the three, takes the three, doesn't make the three. Ball's rebounded by Jones in the corner, finds Shaw. Gives it to Hamlin. Hamlin walks it up the floor. Crossover dribble, dishes left side, Jones. Finds Finley, Finley against Hershey McClellan and goes up tough. Unlike the first half where he hit all that stuff, he's missed his first two opportunities here in the third quarter.
Hershey McClellan really holding himself on defense against Finley.
Medina misses the shot opportunity, ball's on the deck. Medina gets it again, and he's called for the travel.
Good effort by Medina.
Ball's thrown to Jones, but he ducked because he saw Topacio coming. Instead, the ball goes out of bounds over to Daniel McIntyre.
Well, Daniel Mack has to continue putting the pressure on Dakota, creating those turnovers and resulting in some easy points for Daniel.
Ball to be inbounded in the front court by
the Moose would be the
Medina. Tenacious poor. He takes the three, is what I was trying to say, and he hits a three.
He makes it look so easy. Looked like he was going to drive in and just came right back out, took that three-pointer.
Daniel Mack regains the lead, and they come up with a steal. Tenacious poor, full spin. Finger roll, it doesn't go. But what a sweet move by Tenacious poor.
That's just another one out of his playbook.
Ball goes off the legs of Medina, out of bounds to Dakota. 51-50, Daniel McIntyre with the lead. Shaw into Hamlin. They'd like to get it to Finley if they could. Instead, it's worked around the other side. They get it to Gervais instead. Defense collapses, ball's worked around. Jones from about 12 off the rim, doesn't go. Rebounded by Hershey McClellan.
A much needed rebound by IBM.
Ball's almost stolen by Hamlin. He's called for the reach, however. It'll be team foul number two of the half against Dakota. Actually, it's only the first they've called, and it's Hamlin's first of the game as well. Ball's inbounded to Medina. Worked to Tenacious poor. On the baseline, Topacio. Wide open, he's not going to miss that too much.
Well, if there's no defense on him, he's definitely going to take advantage of that. And there we have another turnover by Dakota.
And it seems like the Dakota guards are just breaking down in the backcourt right now. They've got to protect the ball a little bit better. They're down by three right now at 53-50. Ball goes in to Tenacious poor. He pulls up from Buddy. Gets a shot blocked by Gervais. Shaw with it. Almost gets it stolen. Finley gives it to Jones. Ball goes down low, Gervais up in traffic, it's short. Finley with the follow, it doesn't go, and then it's taken by Tenacious poor. Quick pass down the floor. Avila knows, doesn't go for him. Hershey McClellan can't finish. And quickly back the other way is Dakota.
Great action by both teams here. We got a double dribble being called on Jones.
He saw the pass to Finley, and when it wasn't there, he tried pulling the ball back down. And as you mentioned, Missy, a double dribble. Tenacious poor. To Medina, up top to Passio, fakes it, drives it into the paint, puts up a high shot, off the glass and down. He had to go high because Gervais was in his face.
Well, there, for sure, you could see him purposely reaching and shooting that one high because Gervais at 6'10 was coming right at him.
This is Daniel's biggest lead of the game at 5 and 55-50. Both teams have had 5-point leads. Actually, Dakota had a 7-point lead at one juncture, but that didn't last too long.
And it appears right now that we're playing a little more of the Daniel Mack tempo or style.
Now the big man playing some pitch and catch. Finley and Gervais, ball's worked around. Quick ball reversal goes to Shaw. Shot is long, tapped around. Gervais can't control it. Ball goes over to Daniel Mack, and quickly they're off to the races. Favoni trying to get his team back into it. Here they're down by five. Tenacious poor on the outside. Ian Bershley McClellan, the big man, goes long, rebounded by Hamlin.
Well, he pretty much had to take that shot. They left him wide open.
Fans getting a little unruly now here at the Duckworth Center. Oh, nice move by Hamlin. Nice dish. Finley, no mistake this time. He's back in the groove. He's got 23. Tenacious poor crossover dribble, penetration up tough, doesn't go. Finley with the board. Hamlin. to Jones. He's got Gervais as a screen. He goes up and hits it. They call the charge, and they call it before the basket, so it will not count.
And that's a very good call because it looked like the Daniel Mack player, I believe that was Paul Villanoza, did establish position.
And Dean Favoni is shaking his head. I think he believes the shot got off before the contact, but he won't win that battle. It's 55-52, Daniel Mack. Shot goes up by Tapasio, in and out. Finley with another board.
Well, it was all Dakota players underneath the basket there, which is why they came down with that rebound.
Jones back out, Hamlin wide open for three, and he hits it. Tie ball game at 55. Nash is poor to Tapasio, Villanoza. Traveling violation, and Missy just shuffled his feet a little bit.
Yeah, it looks like he's dragging his pivot foot, and that's why he's getting called on the travel. He certainly is questioning that one. Paula Villanoza has worked very hard at his game, and twice a week goes at 7:30 in the morning to work on his game. And there we had another steal by Marvin Tapasio.
Gives Daniel a two-point lead once again. Full court pressure by the Maroons. Lancers trying to break it. Shaw doing it on his own, gets it into the front court. And he travels as he dragged his foot. So things getting a little out of control for both teams here. Nashaspur pulls up for three. It's good. 60-55, Daniel Mack.
Well, Daniel Mack getting a little bit of a lead here, but certainly not walking away with this one yet. Dakota's not ready to throw in the white towel.
Ball goes to Finley. He turns, goes up top, fights for the rebound, doesn't get it. Shaw does. He goes up and gets fouled. This will likely be against Bershley McClellan.
That looked like he got a piece of that one, got called on the foul.
60-55, the score. It is Ian Bershley McClellan picking up the foul. That's his second, Daniel's first of the half.
Bershley McClellan, known for his rebounding for Daniel Mack, but certainly has his work cut out for him tonight as he's up against the big guys, Finley and Gervais.
The first is good for Shaw. Daniel Mack makes some substitutions.
Trevor Shaw was the Junior Varsity Dakota Athlete of the Year last year, and he's also a member of the volleyball team, so a very good athlete for Dakota.
Rupert Capena and Roy Rodriguez coming back into the ball game. They replace Bershley McClellan and Medina. Second opportunity is also good for Shaw, because you know Shaw is always good. Back the other way, Nashaspor dishes off. Shot is drained by Capena. 5-point lead once again for Daniel Mack. It's 62-57, 3:40 to go in the third.
Rupert Capena, one of the utility players, is youngest of five boys.
10-second violation called against Dakota. They couldn't get the ball across center within 10. The ball goes over to the Daniel McIntyre Maroons.
Well, Dakota struggled a little bit even last night against Oak Park with that pressure, so I'm surprised Daniel Mack hasn't done more of that tonight.
Nash is poor. Three-point territory, works off the screen, dishes off. Capena, shot doesn't drop for him. Players battling for the ball. Gervais comes up with it, but on the alternating possession, Daniel will hang on to the rock.
It's like Coach Bouchard and Lazouk are taking turns getting off the bench, shouting out instructions to their team. Daniel Mack doing a very good job. They're ready to inbound that ball.
Nashaspor, three-point territory, goes inside to Villanoza. He'll spot up. Shot doesn't fall for him. Rebounded by Tapasio underneath. Kicks it out. Capena. His shot won't fall. Maroons crashing the boards, and the ball will stay in the hands of Daniel McIntyre.
Just over 3 minutes left in this third quarter. Daniel Mack leads 62-57.
And they have the ball. It goes into the key. Big block by Gervais. Daniel Mack hangs onto the ball. They almost turn it over, and now they'll come in an over-back violation. Dakota will get possession with 3 minutes even to go here in the third.
A.J. Gervais ranked the number six player in the province, showing his good defensive abilities.
Hamlin, double-teamed, almost loses the ball, and they're going to call a foul on Irfan Nashaspur. I believe that's his second, if I'm not mistaken. No, it's only his first. Team foul number two of this half. Lancers with 2:54. They have the ball, but they trail by five at 62-57. Jones into the front court. To Hamlin, back to Jones. Again, Dakota trying to establish their two posts down low. One of them, Gervais, gets the ball, gets it back to Shaw. Gervais again to Shaw. Three-point shot is good. Great shooting here by Shaw tonight.
Well, Trevor Shaw did that last night, and he's starting to turn things on again tonight.
62-60, Daniel McAvely. They've got the ball. Nash is poor. He says, whatever you can do, I can do better. Jones back the other way. Bounce pass ahead to Hamlin. 65-60. Nash is poor, I believe, is over 20 now for Daniel Mack. Hamlin tries to get it across to Jones. It's knocked out of bounds. Ian Burschley and McClellan reporting back to play now for the Maroons with 2:07 to go here in the third. 65-60, Daniel Mack. And we've got a timeout on the floor called by Daniel McIntyre. Once again, to reiterate, the Daniel McIntyre Maroons 65, the Dakota Lancers 60, with 2:07 to go here in the third. And we'll see if we can eavesdrop on one of the huddles.
Touch it. They've got to touch it on every possession. Okay? Trevor, don't leave him. Okay, don't help anywhere else. Don't leave him. Okay? We're good. Here we go. 3, 2, 1. Let's convert him, big guy. Convert him.
The Maroons breaking their huddle and returning to the floor. Dakota will have the ball in the front court with 2:07 to go here in the third.
Daniel Mack also with some solid coaching. We mentioned Greg Mouchard was the coach of the Canada Summer Games team, and Carrie Lazouk was a Basketball Manitoba Coach of the Year. Recently got married, and he wrote down here to a great girl named Bernadette, and we'd like to congratulate them because they were also expecting their first child.
Well, I didn't know that. And Bernadette's just sitting two rows in front of us here, so we get her attention, we'll congratulate her. And right now, Alexi Finley at the line. Hits the first. He's got 24. And Finley hits the second. He's smooth.
Finley, also known as Q.
Oh, Nash is poor. Puts up the shot. Finley gets a swat on that one. Gervais with the board. Hamlin comes up with it, gives it to Shaw, right back to Hamlin. Full court pressure, they've got to break it. They almost throw it away. Lancers will get another opportunity to get the ball across center. Hamlin into the front court, guarded by Nashespour. Almost stolen, gives it to Shaw. Shaw to Finley. Finley up top, he hits it, and he's fouled. 27 on the night for Finley.
65-64, Daniel still leading, but we've got Finley at the line for Dakota. 1:32 left in this third quarter. This is still anyone's game.
If Finley should hit this free throw, it would tie the game at 65. It would also give him 28 on the night if he's successful, but he isn't. Ball's rebounded by Rodriguez. Remains a one-point ball game. National Sport lead pass, IBM. Doesn't hit it. We have a foul. I'm not sure if that's Nash's score on an over the back violation, but there is a technical foul being called against Nash's score. We'll get the signal from Phil Sam.
So the foul was called on Nash's score as well as the technical. Looked like he was maybe saying a few things to the official.
And you see Carrie Lasuk in the background. A little disbelieving as Phil Sam comes over to explain his call to the coaching staff of Jason Papone, Greg Bouchard, and Carrie Lasuk.
That's right. They just wanted a clarification as to what happened in that situation, and Jones puts in the first shot.
So Jones, as you mentioned, hits the first to tie it at 65. We've got 1:23 to go in the third. The second of the technical being taken and being made by Jones.
On Dakota taking advantage of that technical foul being called against Irfan Nashespour.
Nashaspor has three fouls now on the evening.
And that is most definitely a player they cannot afford to lose.
And, you know, he's got to keep his cool and not say things to the officials in a game as important as this. Three-point attempt from the outside is long. Finley mops it up and drops it down. He's got 29 on the evening, and we've got 105 to go in the third. Tapasio, three-point territory to Nashaspor. Nashaspor crossover dribble kicks it out. Tapasio from three-point territory. It's good. We're tied at 68. What a great game this is. Shaw to Hamlin, less than a minute to go. Ball's passed ahead to Shaw, his hands in out of bounds. Good job on defense being done by Daniel Mack. Nashaspor back the other way, working at Shaw, spots up for the tray. No good, mopping up Ian Bursley McClellan.
Well, good job by Ian. That's what he needs to do for Daniel, is get position underneath the boards and hold down some of those rebounds.
Gervais comes back to help out, gives it to Jones, who's got a breakaway, and he hits it. We're tied at 70, 23 seconds to go. Daniel Mack with the ball, back the other way. Irfan Nashaspor, number one ranked player in the province, directing traffic, 15 seconds to go. Daniel looks like they're gonna play for one. And you gotta know the one is number one, the top rated guy in the province. Nashaspor kicks it out. Tapasio's three is good. With just 3 seconds remaining in the quarter. Long attempt, almost goes in. It's 73-70, Daniel Mack after three quarters of play. Neither team giving an inch here in the third quarter. Missy, wow, what an absolutely great game we've seen here so far.
Well, you know, it's a game like this that almost has you speechless. I mean, it's just gone back and forth. One team shooting the three-pointer, next thing you know, the other team comes down and responds with the exact same shot. This has just been a fantastic, you couldn't ask for a better final.
Oh, you really couldn't. It's a great way to end the boys' season. We're still not done yet. We've got a quarter left to go here. And who knows, the way these two teams are going, it might be more than a quarter.
It definitely has the potential to go into overtime.
One of the things we haven't talked too much about has been the play of Alexi Finley. We keep mentioning his point total. He's at 29 right now. But he's quietly got 29 by dominating underneath for Dakota.
That's right. He's underneath the boards. He's hauling down a lot of the rebounds. They're trying to dish the ball into him, and he's inside for some of those easy shots. Now, I say they're easy because he's in close proximity to the basket, but some of the players are all over him.
Yeah, they've been draped all over, and they're very quick to get back in and cause interference for him when he's been trying to make those shots, but he's stayed composed and been tough underneath. So
that's right.
Neither team giving in. It looks like we've got a great fourth quarter coming up, and we're just about ready here to start it as Phil Sam, our official, has the ball. We get a look at the great crowd there. Phil Sam gives it up to Hamlin. Dakota with the ball, and it's Shaw. He goes into the front court. Gives it back to Hamlin. Down low, Gervais.
Gervais been a little bit quiet lately.
He's been double-teamed most of the night, too, and he goes up there and hits it, so cutting the lead back to one.
At 6'10", he'll be a nice addition to the U of M squad next year.
So they join Rick Suffield's program. Nashaspor with a shot doesn't go. Ball's on the deck. Nashaspor gives it up underneath, and it's no good. Finley with the board, gives it to Shaw. Hear the fans just groaning at that, and we have an over-back violation called against Gervais as he was in the front court and landed in the back court when he came down with the ball.
That's right, another good call. And he's explaining that to the players right now.
73-72, Daniel Mack. And we have a foul being called against Dakota, much to the dismay of the fans.
And that call against Trevor Shaw, but that's something that I saw a lot of last night as players, when they're being picked, is they're pushing off with the hand, and he got caught on that one.
Nashaspor with the ball, his team up by one. We're just a minute into the fourth. Tapasio, Villanoza. Villanoza back to Tapasio. It's Medina now. Goes back to Nashaspor, works off the screen. Goes around a couple players, nice move underneath, kicks it back out. And Villanoza makes no mistake as he puts that one down.
Well, that's a good play by Nashaspor. He didn't have the shot himself, so he dished it off to a teammate.
Finley gets hit from behind and the ball goes out of bounds. It'll stay in Dakota's possession, 75-72. Alexi Finley hands the ball off to Shaw, back to Hamlin, gives it to Shaw. Jones down low, Gervais double teamed again, but he goes up and he hits it. Gervais coming alive here in the fourth.
And Dakota taking advantage of that mismatch as far as height.
75-74, Daniel Mack, 1 point lead, they have the ball. Medina to Tapasio, right side. Avila-Noza. So firstly, McClellan, short shot doesn't go, he gets his own rebound, almost loop. He does lose it, I should say, but coming back and making no mistake is Avila-Noza.
Avila-Noza showing that, shows that it pays off working hard as he's in the gym quite often at 7:30 in the morning.
Hamlin with the ball, drives, puts up the finger roll, it doesn't go, it's rebounded by Bershon McClellan. And Erfan Nashaspour is hurt, he's limping off right now. Don't know if he's twisted his ankle or what, but he's certainly in some pain. He's trying to walk it off, but it looks like we're going to get a quick sub, and it's going to be Rupert Kapina coming back into the ballgame.
Well, and that would be extremely, extremely sad for Daniel Mack. That is a player that, I mean, they cannot afford to lose.
We'll try and keep you updated on that. Maybe Bob Baker can find out what's going on, but right now, Nashaspour is out of the ball game. 7:40 to go. Daniel Mack with the ball and a three-point lead at 77-74. Tapasio gets a shot blocked by Gervais. Finley with the board gives it to Shaw. Shaw, crossover dribble. Gets it ahead eventually to Jones. Three-point attempt, no good.
That's a huge board by IBM.
Back the other way. That's Medina. His shot doesn't go. Gervais with the board. Gives it to Shaw. Lancers turning the ball over. Tapasio, he goes up and hits it. 79-74. 7 minutes to go.
It's always interesting when there's an injury to see how a team responds. Sometimes they really pick up their play and try and play for that injured player. And right now, Daniel is not slowing down at all.
Gervais got the ball, but he was hammered in the face by Paul Avila. Noses, we see Nashaspour getting treated.
Foul.
They're calling it his third. I thought it was his fourth as well, as we see Nashaspour getting, we saw him getting some treatment there. We have a timeout called on the floor. 79-74 the score in favor of Daniel McIntyre. 6:51 to go here in the fourth quarter.
Dribble to get out of the pressure. Don't pick it up near center. Keep going. Don't pick it up near center. Don't pick it up near timeline. Every possession, AJ or Q must touch the ball. They must touch the ball. Run regular circle. Post pop out. Other one dive down. Three comes high. Okay? Relax. 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 Okay? You got space, dribble. Fake a pass, then make a pass. Let's go. 3-2-1.
Foster! Last shot.
Defense is your priority.
You guys, three, two, one.
Let's get some rebounds. Let's get some rebounds.
We heard mostly the comments of Dean Favoni in his timeout. One of the key things he said was to relax, protect the ball, and you get into a provincial championship, Missy. I mean, it's a big enough game as it is, but with all these fans screaming, it's easy to start racing and getting too ahead of yourself. Just do the things you did well to get here, and you'll be successful.
Sorry, it's easier said than done, but
way
you do definitely want to keep your players nice and relaxed so they can play composed and under control.
Gervais hits the first, cutting the lead to four, 79-75, 6:51 to go.
Well, Daniel Mack still with the lead, but not a comfortable lead.
Gervais.
Looks like on the sideline that they are going to tape Nashaspour's ankle, so we'll probably see him back in the game. That's a good sign if they're going to be taping it right now.
Medina for Daniel Mack. Gives it to Kapina, who in turn gives it to Tapasio. Tapasio gets the ball back. Ball fake on Finley. Drives. Looking for help. It's intercepted by Jones. And Jones will try and settle things down. Hamlin to Shaw. Again, Dakota's got to get control of the ball and get into the front court. Jones with it. across to Shaw. Gervais up high in the high post. We have an offensive foul being called against Finley, who got tied up, I believe, it was with the University of McClellan. And that's the third foul against Finley, team foul number four. Daniel Mack, 4-point lead, 6:10 to go. They start up the floor. Promises to be a great ending to this game here. Medina, high arcing three-pointer is long. Ball's on the deck, who's got it? It's Ian Bershley McClellan. He almost loses it as Gervais got a hand on it but couldn't control it.
Again, good defense by the Dakota team. Daniel still looking to put some points on the board here and extend their lead.
Topacio over to Medina inside of Villanoza. Topacio works off the screen, pulls up for the shot, doesn't fall. Bershley McClellan gives it across. It's Capino with the shot. And before we get down the floor, let's get a report from Bob on Earth Aid National Sport. Bob?
He just rolled over on it. It's going to be a mild sprain. The athletic therapist is taking over right now, and he hopes to be back as soon as possible.
Thank you very much, Bob. Good reporting on the sidelines here as we see Gervais go up and hit the basket. And he's fouled. The lead is cut to 2 with 5:10 to go. Ian Bershley McClellan, IBM, picking up his third.
And he's definitely had his work cut out for him underneath the boards as he's outmatched size-wise by both Finley and Gervais. So he's definitely had to work hard for any of the rebounds that he's hauled down, and that's something he's done well all year for Daniel Mack.
1-point ball game now after Gervais hit the free throw to complete the three-point play. We have exactly 5 minutes remaining in the fourth quarter. 79-78, Daniel McIntyre leading Dakota in this provincial 4A boys basketball championship game.
Looks like Daniel has chosen to slow things down a little bit, show a little bit of patience.
They also want to, I'm sure, not get into too much of a running game without their leader, and they'd like to get him back in the ballgame soon. That was Medina, I should say, going up tough. He doesn't hit it, but he is fouled.
Well, and that one almost dropped in for him, but that'll put him to the line, so he'll be shooting 2, 79-78. Daniel Mack only leads by one, just over 4.5 minutes left.
They called that foul against Hamill, and that's his second. The first is no good for Medina. Daniel Mack clinging to a 1-point lead.
Medina was the player to hit that three-point to force the overtime against one of the earlier games, the quarterfinals against Glenlawn.
A game where they nearly got upset. They were down by 5 with a minute 28 to go, and they came back and forced the OT. And now it's a 2-point lead for Daniel Mack. It's Jones with the ball. He advances into the front court, works down the left side, guarded by Medina. Jones looking for Gervais. It's knocked out of bounds. Dakota will hang on to the ball with 4:26 to go here in the fourth. Ball's entered in to Finley. It's knocked out of bounds again. Shaw to do the honors again on the baseline. Gets it into Finley. Back to Shaw. Fakes it. Pulls up just inside the three-point line. A little strong. Rebounded by Bershley McClellan.
Another nice rebound by Ian Bershley McClellan.
Ball goes across to Medina. Capina now gives it down low to Villanoza. Up top to Passio. Works it across Medina. Medina to Capina. Inside, Bershley McClellan. Going up against Gervais. Doesn't hit it. Hamlin comes up with the board, 3:49 to go. It's still a 2-point ball game. And Irfan Nashaspour is getting ready to check back in to the delight of the Daniel Mack fans.
Well, Ian Bershley McClellan has to make sure he gets those easy shots in.
Going up tough is Finley. He's knocked to the floor. Gervais can't hit it. Ball's tapped around. Saved by Daniel McIntyre. And they come back the other way. Topacio inside. That was Capina, now back to Topacio, 3:20 to go. Medina with the ball, directing traffic. And penetrates the key, goes up with a shot, it doesn't go. Gervais gets the rebound, it remains 80-78, Daniel Mack.
Daniel starting to miss some of those easy ones, just forcing that ball off the backboard, a little too strong on the shot.
Under 3 minutes to go now, 2-point ball game. Ball's entered into the high post to Finley, kicks it across to Jones, doesn't take the three, gives it to Hamlin. Back to Jones, it's almost stolen by Topacio. And that's a whistle that Daniel McIntyre wanted.
Right.
As you can hear, the fans cheering.
The crowd goes crazy with the entrance of Irv Van Asschepoort back into the game. Obviously his ankle a little bit weak, but
he's gonna tough it out as Gervais goes up and gets fouled. And if this is Bershley McClellan, it might be his fourth.
I believe they're giving it against number 5, Paul Avellanosa.
You are correct, that is his fourth. So he's now playing in a bit of foul trouble with 2:45 to go.
Looks like they're gonna put Roy Rodriguez back into the game.
Gervais hits the first. The lead is cut to one.
Well, I'm sure everyone's enjoying this game at home because I'll tell you, it's excitement here.
He missed a second, but Finley cleans up with the rebound after. It's a 1-point lead for Dakota, and their fans go crazy. It's 81-80, 2:35 to go.
And I think Daniel, besides getting some points on the board, has to put some pressure on Dakota, create some of those turnovers. They've gone back to a Dakota game.
Topacio almost turned the ball over. Instead, Medina gets it working in on Hamlin. Penetrates the key, goes up against Gervais. And they're calling a foul. Who's it going to be against? It looks like it's Hamlin picking up his third. And all the Dakota players are saying that they were standing up straight. The officials, though, disagree.
Well, we talked on many broadcasts in the past how games are won or lost at the line. And here Daniel has an opportunity to tie and possibly regain the lead.
Drew and Medina, his first. It's good. We're tied at 81.
Well, they don't call him Funky Cole Medina for nothing.
No, they call him that for money. And that's exactly what he is on the line right now. He's money as he misses the second, though. And there's a lane violation being called against Daniel McIntyre as they were in before the ball got to the rim.
Or is he calling a foul?
Or actually, no, you're right. It is a foul they're calling. And it's
That's his fifth and disqualifying foul.
Against Avellanosa. And it's also a bonus situation. I believe they're in the two-shot bonus. Daniel McIntyre will take full use of this 30-second break they've got here. So we take a look at Phil Sam.
Get some movement out of our offense. We've got to have some movement, okay? Who's high post, Roy?
Not a guarantee here, boys. No guarantee they're going to make two.
Dig down. Dig down. Get the box host one and done. Let's come this way. One and done on the defense.
We have 3 timeouts left, so we've got timeouts to you. Ready? 3, 2, 1.
Run. What do we got left for timeouts?
2:18 to go. Daniel McIntyre, 81. Dakota, 81. The Lancers going to the line in the bonus situation. We're not sure if it's 1-1 or 2. Yes, it is 2 because it is 10 fouls. The officials just conferring on that. At the line with 29 points, Alexi Finley, one of the stars of this championship game.
This is almost too exciting to call.
That's probably why I'm doing all the talking. 82-81. Alexi Finley with that basket. Missy will just sit and enjoy the remaining 2:18 here, I'm sure, as Finley hits them both. He's got 31 on the night. As we continue, Asschepoort with the ball. Gives it off to Topacio. Ball's worked around to Medina. Medina thought about the three, instead gives it up to Asschepoort.
Less than 2 minutes in this last and final quarter, unless it goes to overtime. Pascio goes up for the shot, doesn't drop in, and again, Gervais comes down with the rebound for Dakota.
Gervais with the board, it's huge. 1:40 now remaining, 83-81 Dakota, they have the ball. Jones, Hamlin, back to Jones. Hamlin. They're trying to get it into Gervais. They do. He's quickly double-teamed.
They're also taking a lot of time off the clock, and they are ahead by two.
Shot didn't go. Gervais with a rebound. He hits an 85-81. 4-point lead for Dakota, 1:18 to go. Timeout called by Daniel McIntyre with 1:17 remaining. The Dakota Lancers 85, the Daniel McIntyre Maroons 81.
Defense gambles for a steal.
After we score, we gotta be up. We gotta be up.
Switch on that back screen. Switch on the back screen. No, nothing, no threes. Guys, if they keep sagging down and nobody's gonna play you on the perimeter, just hold the ball. I got timeouts if you need them.
Let's do it!
3-2-1! Lancers!
The Daniel McIntyre faithful keeping the faith, as are the Lancers. Lancers leading by four. It's 85-81, 1:17 remaining in the fourth.
Well, and Daniel Mack has been faced with this pretty much identical situation against Glenlawn in the quarterfinals. They were down by about 5 points with about 1:23 left and came back to tie it and force the overtime and then go on to win by 10.
Nash is poor for three. Doesn't go. Gervais with a huge rebound.
Nashaspor is getting some good looks. They're just not dropping in for him right now.
Ball's worked to Jones. Less than a minute to go. Hamlin down low. Gervais up top. Jones to Shaw. Back to Jones.
I think they're going to have to foul him.
And that's indeed what Daniel McIntyre does. Nashaspor with the foul. That is his fourth foul from what we've heard from Bill Anthony here. 4-point ball game, 42 seconds remaining. Marshall Jones, the grade 11 guard at the line. Air balls on the first.
Well, the Daniel Mack crowd really liked that one.
Yeah. In the late stages of a game like this, your legs can get tired, and it's your legs that are the key to the free throw. You got to bend them and shoot. Second one doesn't go. Back the other way is Medina. Quickly down the floor. He goes up and hits a layup. It's cut to two with 33 seconds
to go. Got the pressure being put on by Daniel now.
Shaw works his way up court.
They've
across
got
the
to
center.
Slow it down now. Go for the steal, or they've got to get the foul.
And there's the foul right there.
But a lot of time came off the clock. We've got 20.3 seconds left. 85-83. Dakota leads by two.
And going to the line.
And that's going to be pressure. I mean, teams are going to feel this pressure right now. Game's on the line, basically. And if he gets one, it's still a 1 point or a one possession.
If he hits both, which he won't, it remains a one-possession game. 2-point ball game, 85-83, 20 seconds
to go. One of the best three-point shooters is off the floor right now because Nashaspor is not on the floor.
Hamlin misses the second. Finley gets the board. He goes up tough. Can't hit it. Ball's tapped around. Shaw comes up with it. He's wrestled to the floor.
14 seconds left. It's going to go to, or they're calling a foul.
Yes, they're calling a foul against it looks like number 9, Medina, for wrestling Shaw to the floor. 14 seconds to go. Now these free throws are just as key because it is still a 2-point ball game.
And Shaw, one of the better shooters. This could definitely be the Shaw turning point of the game.
He needs to hit one to ensure that a 3-pointer can only tie.
Well, that is definitely performing under pressure.
If he hits this, it's almost over. Because it would be a two-possession game with 14 seconds to
go. That's
right. even though stranger things have happened. Shaw misses the second. Daniel Mack needs a three to tie, 10 seconds to go. And we have a timeout on the floor called by Daniel Mack with 7.4 seconds to go. 86-83 Dakota.
Well, and I'd be trying to get that ball to Tapacho. He is one of the best shooters from the outside. Nashaspor is not on the floor right now. Obviously, that ankle giving him far too much trouble. So I'd be trying to isolate as much as possible to Tapacho.
And not only is the ankle giving him problems, he's getting it iced right now. He will not be back on for the remaining 7 seconds.
Rupert,
let's listen in.
And then, Rupert, I want you on the ball side. I want you to pop out in case we can't go there. We might have to hit you for a three. Okay? Let's go.
Hey. Okay, you're going to have to get right by your guy, okay? It's up here. It's up here.
The fans on the Dakota side of the Duckworth Center here are excited. The fans around us on the Daniel McIntyre side have suddenly gone quiet.
Well, Dakota can kind of taste this one right now, but I'll tell you, this game is still not over. They get that ball in, if they get an open look, and they can force overtime here.
And we now have a timeout on the floor called by Dakota. They saw something they didn't like. They called timeout. Let's set the stage for you. 7.4 seconds remaining. Dakota leads at 86-83. However, Daniel McIntyre has the ball at half court. Let's listen in now to Dakota.
We want to get Rupert to the ball in here if we can.
Got it? They need a three. Sheet everywhere else. If they score a two, don't even pick it up. But if they score a two, don't pick it up. Here we go. 3-2-1.
Very good point there made by Dean Favoni. Daniel should only score two. There won't be enough time. They don't have to touch the ball and inbound it.
And what they don't want to do is foul them on that play, because if by chance the ball was to drop in and then they get them at the foul line, that'd be a huge mistake.
So what will Daniel McIntyre do? 7.4 seconds to go. Ball's inbounded. It's Capina. Gives it to Tapasso. He puts up the three. It's no good. But Dakota Lancers, in a stunning upset, defeat the Daniel McIntyre Maroons 86-83. They are the Manitoba Provincial 4A High School Boys Basketball Champions. Two teams shake hands. Missy, this is the first time in a long time since Dakota's won the provincial basketball championship.
That's right. They just won their seventh provincial championship. They were going after that tonight. The last time they won was 1980, so it's been 22 years. We talked about the Cinderella story. People weren't sure if they could continue this after the big upset against the number one Rango Park, but I'll tell you, their big guy showed up tonight ready to play.
And there he is. He is indeed number one. We have him unofficially at 31 points. Let's go down to Bill Anthony, who's going to announce the presentations of the medals and the hardware. Bill?
And now the awards presentations for the 2002 4A Provincial High School Boys Championships. I'd like to congratulate these teams. I'd like to take this opportunity to acknowledge our sponsors, the Manitoba Milk Producers, who are the major sponsor for this event, as well as McDonald's Restaurants of Manitoba, Harvell Sportswear, Wilson Sports, and Sport Manitoba. Please welcome the awards presenters, Murray Brown from the Board of Directors of MHSAA, Tina Kravierdos from the Manitoba Milk Producers, and Debbie May of the All-Star Committee, along with Ashley Derlego of MHSAA Board of Directors. Would the captains of the Daniel McIntyre Maroons please come forward and receive the finalists' banner. I'd like to now call on each member of the Daniel McIntyre Maroons to please step forward and receive their second place medallions. Marvin Tapascio. Number 5, Paul Alvinoza. Number 6, Mark Molnar. Number 7, Mike Tan. Number 8, Marco Lopez. Number 9, Jerwin Medina. Number 10, Ken Massasseur. Number 12, Ian Gershley McClellan. Number 13, Irfan Najpour. Number 14, Jason Paleo. Number 15, Rupert Capina. Number 23, Roy Rodriguez. Number 30, Aaron Goodmanson. Number 11, Milan Bilanian. Number 20, Josh Teo. And number 4, Justin Marino. Their managers, Steve Mark, Ernol Fabro, and Sambath Sam. And their coaches, Greg Bouchard, Jason Papone, and Terry Lasuk. And now I'd like to call the captains of the Dakota Collegiate Lancers to come and accept their championship banner and trophy. To call on the Dakota Lancers one at a time to come forward and receive their championship t-shirts and championship medallions. Number 13, Marshall Jones. Number 20, Adam Thordeson. Number 21, Trevor Shaw. Number 22, David Harvey White. Number 23, Dan Hamlin. Number 24, Grant Short. Number 32, Dylan Fries. Number 33, Igor Jurek. Number 42, A.J. Gervais. Number 44, Chris Morissette. And number 55, Alexi Findlay. The Dakota Collegiate Lancers trainer is Deanne Bennett. And their coaches, Dean Sacco, Brian Kidd, Corey Rothenberger, and Dean Favoni. At this time, I'd like to get an opportunity to recognize this year's Manitoba Milk Producers Players' Choice Award is selected by the athletes participating in this year's Final Four. Presenting the award is Ashley DeLego from the Players' Choice Committee and Tina Krevziadis from the Manitoba Milk Producers. This year's Manitoba Milk Producers Player Choice Award goes to Daniel McIntyre's Marvin Tapascio. Now the All-Star Awards. Each will receive an MHSAA All-Star Certificate, a t-shirt courtesy of Harvell Sportswear. From Oak Park, Charlie Brake. From Silver Heights, Chris Burns. From Dakota, 17 points in the semi, 21 in the final, A.J. Gervais. From Daniel Mack with 16 points in the semi, 29 here in the final, Marvin Tapascio. From Daniel Mack, 34 points scored in the semifinal, 29 in this final, Irfan Dashbour. And now this year's most valuable player who will receive a Manitoba High School Athletic Association MVP certificate and sweatshirt, compliments of Harvell Sports. The 2002 4A Provincial High School Basketball Championship most valuable player is Alexi Findlay from Dakota. Ladies and gentlemen, a big round of applause for the All-Stars and the players who made this 2002 4A Championship so exciting. On behalf of our sponsors, the Manitoba Milk Producers, we thank you for attending this evening's performance. And remember, Shaw Channel 11 will be rebroadcasting these games tomorrow starting at noon. Until then, we'll see you in the gym.
Well, there you have it. Thank you very much, Bill Anthony. Great job being done again on the public address announcing here at the University of Winnipeg's Duckworth Center. Missy, the Dakota Lancers knock off number one, and then they knock off number two to take the provincial title. Amazing tournament.
Well, definitely. You talk about peaking at the right time, and I mean, they really came out of nowhere to all of a sudden win their zone, their league, and then knock off number one and number two in the provincial final to capture their first championship in 22 years.
And you know, they say you've got to knock off the best teams to become the best, and often to be the best, you've got to beat the best. And certainly Dakota did that not once, but twice here at the provincial championship. So full credit to them, 86-83 victors here over the Daniel Mack Maroons. here at the University of Winnipeg's Duckworth Center. Once again, I'm Sean Coates and Missy Penner joining me. Missy, again, a review for you on the victory here by Dakota and what they did to come away with this provincial title.
Well, they played together as a team, and I think, you know, the two big guys, Finley and Gervais, definitely showed up ready to play. They had to work very hard to get the points and the rebounds. They really turned things around for Dakota. I think the other player that really did an outstanding job was Hamlin, because he had to come in with the injury to Harvey White and control the ball. And that's got to be a very precious situation, even though he's had a lot of playing time before, but still, to know that you're the guy that's going to have to bring that ball up all the time, especially against Daniel Mack, who is known for their aggressive defense and the steals.
Yeah, you get told, hey, guess what, you get to start the provincial championship, but don't screw up. You know, that's quite an accomplishment. And that's one of the things we didn't really get to touch on too much, was the fact that David Harvey White wasn't playing this game, which makes the victory by Dakota even that much more impressive, missing one of their starters and knocking off number one and number two here. It's been amazing for them. They're celebrating right now, as you see on your screen, as they're holding aloft the trophy and getting ready to cut down the nets here at the Duckworth Center. And I believe Bob Baker is ready down at courtside with an interview. And Bob, take it away.
That's right, Sean. I'm here with Harry Lasoup. Unfortunately, it wasn't so good for you. You guys poured it on, but you just came up a little short.
Yeah, we did. Full credit to Dakota. Coach Favoni did a heck of a job preparing his team for tonight. They came with a very good game plan. They knew what they had to do to stop us, and we needed to turn up the heat a little bit more than we did on them, and we didn't quite get that done. But like I said, full credit to them, because they didn't make it that easy for us to do that. And their players stepped up tonight. They really did. So congratulations to Dakota.
Now, if you can put on your other hat, terrific showing for the Manitoba High Schools Athletic Association.
Yeah, I actually didn't notice the crowd till after the game, and I looked around, and it was a full house. There's a lot of excitement. Win or lose, and I know saying losing right now sounds a little bit different, but it's a lot of fun. It's a lot of fun being in this game. It's a lot of fun for the kids. Win or lose, it's just a great experience all around for the spectators, the athletes, the administrators, the teachers, the students, and all the spectators, and of course the athletes.
Now, you guys had some stream rolling, but unfortunately, Herfan came up sore with an ankle. Did you guys have to change your game that much?
It was pretty tough at that point, simply because there's too much going on at the same time, but we didn't know the extent of Irfan's injury, and when he came off and the athletic therapist said it was a sprained ankle, we said tape it up, and Irfan says, I want to go back in, and a sprained ankle, it's one of those things you can't put the back in, and he went in, but it was just hurting too badly. Marvin did his best to step up his point. He's used to feeding off Irfan, and now he had to feed off himself, and he did a great job of doing that. But Dakota did a really good job of keying in on that and stopping it as well.
Well, that's great. If we can get Irfan in here. Irfan, yeah, come on over here. How's the ankle?
I don't know. Can't play on it. It's not bad, though.
Now, you guys had a terrific season. You guys came up here. It was a great challenge. You got to give it to Daniel Dakota.
They just played much harder than us. You know, we came out. We gave it all. They just had a better game.
So where to now?
I don't know yet.
A lot of guys are looking for you to come to the university. You got Brandon, University of Winnipeg. Have you made up any your mind yet?
I don't know. I live pretty close to U of W, so I don't know.
Well, congratulations on a good game. We've had a really good time. Yeah, it was a perfect game for the 4A finals. Thank you so much.
Thanks a lot.
Now with me is Coach Favoni. You had like, it's like a Cinderella story.
Yeah, it's been quite a ride. What a great group of kids. Excellent. Like they committed to a goal at the beginning of the year. We revisited that about February 1st, and we've been on a ride since then. It's been phenomenal. I can't describe it.
Now, you knocked off Oak Park, then you come here and knock off the number two team.
Yeah.
It must feel great.
Yeah, that's a little understatement. Yeah, especially without our starting point guard. So, yeah, it feels fantastic.
So what's up for next year?
I'm not even thinking about tomorrow yet.
Well, good on you. Enjoy it.
Thank you very much.
If I can get in here with Alexei Finlay. You guys had an excellent game. An excellent game. Great hardware. Describe the feeling.
Good. It feels good to do it. We came in with the mindset we're going to do it, and we did what we wanted to do, and we came up with the champ.
You had a couple of big guys on your team. Talk about your teammate.
A teammate? They're good. A wonderful teammate. They give me the ball, let me do what I got to do. I get them the ball, let them do what they got to do. And we come together, and we did what we wanted to do.
Congratulations on a great game. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Now if I can get in Missy and Sean over here. Guys, your opinions on the game?
Well, just a fantastically played game by both teams, and it wasn't like Dakota dominated or anything. It was a great win for them, obviously, but Daniel McIntyre played some excellent basketball as well, and you know, our hats off to both of those teams for playing some fantastic basketball and being good student athletes here.
Missy?
I don't know if I could think.
It's not everyone.